PATV presents Live from Prairie Lights, featuring the best authors and poets on the scene today. From up-and-coming to well-established writers from across the globe, you'll see them right here on PATV.
Okay, that's the idea. Come on in, guys. Oh, is this a perfect crowd? This is amazing. I was just telling Joe that I'd never seen people in a crowd for a reader that seem so comfortable with each other. And then I realized we've got ourselves sort of a neighborhood here, and we've got ourselves some people who are Joe Blair fans. And Okay. Those of you who are expecting to hear the heroic tale of the great Iowa River flood tonight may be disappointed. What we have in Joe Blair's By the Iowa Sea is a highly personal, far more intimate tale of a man whose complex life has begun to crumble as the water begins to rise. Joe Blair grew up a motorcycle kind of guy from New England whose young dreams involved crossing every American landscape with his young wife, adventure at every turn. Many young men of his generation shared such a dream. Dreams like these are frequently overtaken by the slings and arrows of reality. Joe's were. Four unique children, one of whom would test his strength, his maturity, and his adulthood. His lifelong dream of being a writer kicked in, and in the process forced him to examine a number of dangerous choices he was making in his life and others he was about to make. He worked a number of tradesmen's jobs to support his family, found himself being tempted in flirtatious directions by his heating and air conditioning customers. These moments he wrote about with a brutal honesty, unself-serving like the best dialogue in the best films. His arguments with his wife are also perfect example of domestic sorrow laid on the page. His wife, the character he presents us with, is very well written, and she just comes off like a great soul. Yeah. We, the readers, worry for the Blair family as the household begins to rattle. Blair's touching relationship with his learning disabled son, Michael, is never far from the reader's mind, as it is clearly never far from Joe's mind. The writing in this book will take your breath away, and you, the reader, will leave Joe Blair's family with a prayer on your lips and a deep respect for the author of this book. Joe Blair has written a work of nonfiction in the kind of prose one finds in the very best of contemporary fiction. This is what people are calling now creative nonfiction, and this is raising the bar. This is as good as that kind of a book gets. He's like the kind of funny guy you meet whose jokes are all on him. Blair is a deeply spiritual man, and in the religious allegory he occasionally slips into. He is the sinner, ever aware of his shortcomings. I don't mention too much about the fact that he has, in fact, an MFA. He's not just some writer off the street who wrote a beautiful book. I mean, I spoke with Carl Klaus about Joe Blair after I had read the book and loved it. And Carl Klaus, one of the grand writing teachers in Iowa City or anywhere, said, "We couldn't teach that guy a thing," which, true or not, is... He simply refused to learn anything. But I respect Carl's opinion. I've had lunch with Joe Blair twice, both of which changed something in my life. Join in the celebration of the completion and publication of By the Iowa Sea by Joe Blair.
Thanks, Paul. I don't think I'm going to read tonight. Sorry about that. As you guys file out, orderly fashion, I'd like you to just think about what Paul just said and just imagine how good it would have been. Would have been awesome. Before I read anything, I want to just tell you all that I love you. This is my family, my real family, my church family, my Iowa City family. And thank you for being here. Especially I want to thank my wife. I looked for a card that said, "Thank you. I'm sorry. Thank you for letting me publish it, and I'm sorry you published it." But they didn't have a car, so. And I want to thank my writing partner, too, who's sitting right here, Lauren Reese, who almost every section of this book I wrote across the table from her. Lauren. Well, I figure what I'm going to do is, do you like the round one glasses? I thought, just bought them. I thought it made me look better, more writerly. What do you think, Bill? I got to start with something sort of nice. I can't like get into the gnarly stuff right away. I don't think that would do. It's because I had the same problem with the book. I just wanted to start right off like hardcore, gnarly stuff. And it just, people read it and hated me immediately. So I got to make you like me before you hate me. So a little. All right. It helped that she was pretty. She's still pretty. Too pretty for me. I can tell when I look at the photographs of the two of us side by side. Don Hosier down at the supply house says, "I married over my head." Lots of guys make comments like this. I guess the broken bridge look of my nose doesn't match the ruler straight look of hers. And the droopy shape of my eyes don't match. Marion, do you mind, please? I'm just kidding. I was just getting in the flow, Marion. Don't match the crescent moon shape of hers. People don't seem to enjoy my company the way they enjoy Deb's. She has a way of setting people at ease. It's partly her face that does it. Her eyes, unlike mine, take the shape of being very interested in whatever you might be saying, even if what you're saying is uninteresting. They frown at the serious parts and smile at the parts you intend to be funny. This trick makes you believe that she understands exactly what you mean. When the conversation is over, you walk away with the impression that she enjoys your company more than anyone else's in the world. She has a face that wouldn't say no, and I'm sure that had I asked her in the proper way, in the will you marry me way, she wouldn't have refused, but I never did ask her that way. We had been dating for 2 months when we realized that we would be getting married. It was raining and we were sitting in the cab of my gray Ford F-150 pickup truck. The windows were fogged. Mikey. Right. The windows were fogged up because my truck didn't have air conditioning. So I said. Deb nodded, her eyes engaging mine the way they did. We both knew that she would soon be climbing out of the truck and dashing across the black, cold street and running up the two flights of stairs to the tenement apartment she shared with three other women. She would shower, and then she would dress in her ground-round uniform, and she would drive in her car, a little Toyota Celica, with a bad clutch to work. So, I said again, I didn't want her to go. She didn't want to go either. I could tell by her eyes. I guess we're going to get married. She nodded. Again, her eyes narrowing, she understood exactly what I meant. Yes, she said, I think we are. We were never ones for big decisions. Even marriage wasn't a decision we felt qualified to make. Marriage was, like everything else in our lives, just a thing that happened to us, an inevitable thing that overtook us, like aging or fog on the windows. It's not that we didn't love each other. We did. We couldn't get enough of each other. We wanted to be together at all times. On Sundays, we wanted to attend the Sergio Leone double feature at the Brattle Theater in Harvard Square. After class, we wanted to sit together in the stairwells of the 1950s brick buildings on the U-Lowell campus and look out at the black, rain-soaked streets. We wanted to fish for carp together from the gravel parking lots on the Merrimack River, the rain dimpling the surface of the water. We wanted to eat teriyaki steak and cheeses together at Lena's over on North Campus. And we wanted to sleep together, either in her freezing cold tenement or in my tiny, stiflingly hot rent control apartment in Cambridge. We wanted to eat chowder together at the Grog in Newburyport, then go out in the cold wind and swing on the swing set. Deb would scoot over and sit right next to me on the bench seat of the F-150. We'd drive to the county fair in Topsfield, or to the mountains, or to New Orleans, and everything just happened. Nothing we could do about it other than go out and buy a couple of gold rings. Do you want an inscription? Asked the jeweler. We can inscribe something inside if you like. The date, maybe, or maybe a line of poetry? I'd like Deb in mine, I said. What do you want in yours? How about Joe, she said. It's in here. It was that simple, inevitable, that we would each have each other's names inscribed on the insides of our wedding rings. The jeweler, seeing how pleased we were with ourselves, rolled his eyes. If you come up with anything good, he said, let me know. We can always add it later. By then, I had begun to rebuild the old KZ-1000, and in the interim, in a mad fit of showroom passion, mortgaged my future on a new Honda ST-1100, a sleek, fast, sport touring machine that sort of looked like the Batmobile. The morning Deb and I left Massachusetts in the late summer of 1991, a few months after our elopement, the sky was clear and the air was cool. The black seat of the ST-1100 was beaded with dew. I borrowed a towel from my parents to dry it off. We had spent the night at my parents' house because we had already quit our jobs and let our rent-controlled place in Cambridge go. The bike didn't start easily the way the KZ always did. It hesitated and then clattered to life, expelling white smoke from the exhaust pipes. I had spent days loading our gear. I fabricated a luggage rack and backrest out of the rolled steel and pine slats. I strapped the tent sideways across the homemade rack and mounted the sleeping bags and pads on top of the fiberglass saddlebags like jet engines. This was to be the beginning of the first real journey of our lives together. We weren't sure where we were going. We weren't sure whether or not we could return to Massachusetts. All we knew was that we had a motorcycle and a tent, two sleeping bags, two leather coats, and two pairs of chaps, rain gear, long underwear, helmets, a few books, jeans, boots, maps, and $7,000 cleverly hidden in a white gym sock. These were the possessions that separated us from destitution. The ST-1100 clunked between gears as I pulled onto Route 495 with my new bride. Fred, do you know why that happens? Do you? It always did. With my new bride in the back, leaning on the sissy bar I had constructed, her hands unzipping the pockets of my black leather jacket and tucking themselves inside, the drops of dew on the tank drawing themselves into retreating lines, third gear, fourth, clunk, fifth, away from Billman's Orchard and Littleton and Chelmsford and Lowell and all the towns that had huddled around me for as long as I could remember, close and giant family members, away from them, and local union 537, where I had completed my apprenticeship in the refrigeration trade, and my father. Deb, he's not bad. I'm sorry. And my father, who waited until we were out of sight before he stopped waving. Deb wore her hair in a single thick braid that she tucked inside her leather jacket. I could feel her sigh. She was leaving, too. Leaving was one major reason we got married. I wanted to leave, and she wanted to leave. We wanted to leave together. I didn't want to be the old guy in the Boston bar who sighs heavily and says, "I always wanted to leave." Little did I know I'd become the old guy in the Iowa City bar who sighs heavily and says, "I don't know why the hell I ever came here." We made our way northward into the dense tangle of woods of eastern Massachusetts and Vermont and Quebec. We didn't know it then, but we were young. We had thick hair and lots of hope. And when you're young and full of hope, you think that your leaving home constitutes a coming of age, a story that hinges on a character who starts out as a child and through some series of events becomes a real-life grown-up. It's a common blueprint. The protagonist is young, full of wonder and earnestness and lust and anger, and he descends somehow, falls, or is thrown out. Either way, he leaves the garden behind. Deb and I ran out of money in Iowa. "We have 1,000 left," said Deb, folding the bills and shoving them back inside the white gym sock. We were in a tent on the shore of Lake McBride in Solon, Iowa, and it was raining as hard as I have ever seen it rain. In the Northeast, you get storms whipping up the coast that have names, Rachel, Agnes, Bob, and you get excited and drive to the ocean so you can see the big waves come crashing against the rocks. But hurricanes in the Northeast always disappoint. When you're a kid and you don't have anything to lose, you always want hurricanes to be bigger and more destructive than they turn out to be. All you end up with is a few broken plate glass windows and a few old tool sheds that have collapsed. Iowa thunderstorms, on the other hand, don't disappoint. Midnight black clouds that spawn dozens of tornadoes like wicked little devil children, straight line winds of up to 100 miles an hour. When you hear the sirens, it doesn't mean you should jump into your car and drive somewhere so you can be entertained by the storm. It means build an ark, mother of mine. Because God is coming. The flash and crack of the storm was exploding all around our little brown Coleman tent. I was afraid. I looked at Deb, her features lit every so often by the strobe lightning that kept coming. "What?" I said. 1,000, she shouted. "What?" I shouted. We were inches apart, but the sound of the rain against the tent mixed with the thunder was deafening. "You heard me." "Jesus Christ," I shouted, but I didn't mean it in a bad way. "Where did it all go?" I felt like Captain America must have felt an easy rider when he said, "We blew it, man." "Canada was pretty expensive," she shouted. "Last time I made it to California and back on $1,500. "Not this time," she shouted. That same week, we rented a small brick house 7 miles west of Iowa City on what the locals call the old IWV, which was the main highway from Iowa City to Des Moines before I-80 came through in the mid-50s. The house we rented was one of three, sitting all in a row up on a ridge and a gentle swell of land. The three brick houses were built for the three shift workers who spent their days and nights attending to what was at one time an oil line pumping station. The pumping station had been removed, but the houses were still there, wedged between a hog farrowing pen and the old-style distribution warehouse. There was a small bunch of buildings around about a mile or so to the south and west that maps designated as a town, a Catholic church and an old schoolhouse and a few houses. The school had been converted to a community center. There were middle-aged guys played pickup basketball there on weekends, but these details didn't interest us. We believed that we were only stopping in Iowa for a brief spell until we built up our war chest once again. For now, however, the little brick house would serve as our temporary home. We would pretend to be country folk with the pigs and the corn and stuff, and the motion would stop for a while. A solitary meadowlark always returned to the phone line that ran in from the highway. I had never seen or heard one before, and I fell in love with it, declaring the meadowlark my new favorite bird. I built flower boxes for the first front two windows because Deb wanted them. She had this vision of what a home was supposed to look like. In the fall, we bought our first pumpkin, carved it up, put a candle inside it, and placed it beside the front door on Halloween night. We even bought a bag of fun-sized Snickers bars, but we were in the country and no kids came. Across the street, Long after the corn had been harvested, cows would wander around silently in the gray light of winter, and we'd watch them. From the front stoop, Deb and I both got jobs at a hardware store in the town of Oxford. It was owned by Al and Mary Wyberney, a handsome couple somewhere in their mid-60s. I helped Al with the water heater replacements and faucet repairs, while Deb worked with the century-old store on Main Street with Mary. Mary taught Deb the difference between hex bolts and carriage bolts and lag bolts and toggle bolts, and she instructed her to dust the lamps and small kitchen appliances and fans and little porcelain angels and kitty cats that cluttered the shelves. We were trying to behave the way we imagined married people were supposed to behave. We were doing our best. But even when Deb announced one very cold day in January that she was pregnant, it felt less like we were living in the moment than we were watching it on TV. The mother-to-be learns to cook casseroles. The father-to-be quits his job at the hardware store and goes back to the heating and air conditioning trade in the hard-working blue-collar city of Cedar Rapids. He dresses in the winter in his winter Carhartts and kisses his wife in the morning, leaving with a bag lunch, loving handwritten note tucked inside, and returns again past dark to the delicious odor of some hamburger-based casserole bubbling in the oven. We painted the baby's bedroom a duckling yellow. In the spring, Deb painted the multicolored Deb planted multicolored pansies in the flower boxes I had built all along the front walk. We bought a nice baby crib, not the cheaper one, but the more expensive one, which we quickly learned did not include a mattress. So, of course, we bought one of those, too, and a fringe and a comforter set with apples and balls and cats and all the letters of the alphabet. The comforter was small and much too stiff to conform to any shape, let alone the shape of a baby, but it didn't matter. There was a certain color in it that matched the curtains, and Deb wanted it, so we bought it. Midsummer, we discovered the joy of fresh sweet corn sold by farmers' daughters who set up folding chairs behind the father's pickup trucks in gas station parking lots. We bought the mandatory plastic mobile that clips to the side of the crib and plays music when you turn the crank. Our big treat was waking up early and eating breakfast together at the sale barn in Oxford, where the farmers auctioned off their cattle and hogs. There was no menu because the sale barn only offered one breakfast, two eggs, with yolks of mustard, orange, fresh bacon, and wheat toast. We bought a rocking chair we couldn't afford, but Deb insisted upon it because she imagined herself sitting in that particular rocking chair while she breastfed our first child. By September, we thought we were ready. We figured we had done everything correctly, all the preparation we had done, all the waiting and pretending. And I'm going to read a different section. So that's the kind of nice section. I had to pick sections that weren't absurdly inappropriate for the audience. So that left me with like three. So that's what I'm reading. That's it. This is number two. And this isn't even really appropriate. The heck with it, darn it. When Deb finishes her shift at St. Luke's, it is a great relief. Well, let me just tell you that the next section, we had four children. Sam, William, Lucy, and Michael. And one of the twins is autistic. Michael, we love him very much. He's a little difficult. It caused us a bit of strain in the past. This is after. Let's jump ahead 15 years in the timeline, and then we come to this moment. It wasn't like the next week that this moment happened. It was when Deb finished her first shift at St. Luke's. It is a great relief and a bright light in the darkness for both of us to jump in my truck and drive down to the Wig and Pen. There's a gas fireplace and an old-fashioned English pub-type atmosphere, an atmosphere that is very even and calm, and if it could talk, it would say, "There, there, it's okay. It's all right. I'll take care of you. Why don't you stay for a while? Yes, that's it. Have a drink. There, now. Are you feeling better? Terrific. That's terrific. Now, let me tell you something. You know all that bullshit out there? Out those doors? That bathtub stuff and raw sausage stuff and the pee in the register stuff, that's not real. No, no, it's not, my little friend. No, all that stuff, it's an illusion. The wig and pen has become part of our routine. We always order the same thing, a pitcher of Bass, and I'll smoke one or two cigarettes. This is 4 years ago, right? For a short while. Don't do it anymore. A new habit for me. The nicotine goes to my head. The alcohol goes there too, and I climb into my little airplane and take a test flight around the ceiling of the pub up there where the smoke is. The smoke that might be clouds up there where the ceiling fan wheels slowly and silently on its bearings. So, says Deb, when we're settled at the table near the fireplace, I went through the Verizon bill today. Yeah? I say, I'm not looking at her. I'm looking at the TV, which is mounted up high in the corner behind the bar. It's Cubs baseball. Derek Lee is up. Yeah. You have anything to say? About what? About who you've been calling? When? I say, you know when. She says, no. I say, shifting my gaze to her and then back to the TV, I don't. That's why I'm asking. That's bullshit, she says. You don't call someone 10 times and, oh, Jesus, I shout, that frickin' guy. What guy? Lee, I say, as Derek Lee's strikeout victim walks slowly back to the dugout. When I was a kid, I watched this TV special about a guy who sailed around the world all by himself. And like every kid who watched that show, I thought, maybe someday I'll sail around the world all by myself, too. I thought it was possible. Why not? Some might say the difference between being a kid and being a grown-up is that grown-ups don't think that they will sail around the world all by themselves. Why not? Because they don't have a sailboat. Because they couldn't make the mortgage payments if they sailed around the world. Because they don't know how to sail. Because they don't want to. Because it's just a TV show. There can be lots of becauses. There can be endless becauses. Because you're a grown-up, because you have responsibilities, because you haven't made one choice in the last 10 years, because, and here's the important one, you're a coward. Yes, that's right, because you, my little friend, are a coward. When you're a child, on the other hand, your entire thought process is consumed with visions of what might be. You are propelled forward in search of some foggy thing, something that you believe might be amazing, what you might do, who you might be. You imagine that there are so many possibilities. I don't put sandwiches in the freezer for my lunch anymore like I did when I was a kid, thinking they'll keep just fine and taste great later in the week. And I don't so much chase the future as I try to avoid being caught by the misery my ex-future has turned out to be. Our history gains more weight day by day. There can be no denying this. And the future seems more and more unlikely to be anything cool at all. And my circumstances seem more and more difficult to change. I think it would take a great act of faith or courage to change my circumstances when my life is nothing but a repetition and a repetition. And the more I repeat, the more afraid I become of change and the less able I am to believe I can have any effect on my own life. And yet somehow I'm always advising others to be brave and have the courage to change their circumstances. In fact, I'm the Pied Piper of what you might call freedom. You just need to get the hell out of here, I told Matt Strong last Monday night. I know it was Monday night because Saul Uberoth was blowing his horn and they had the Hammond B3 set up blocking the front entrance at George's Tap, and that's what they do on Monday nights. They call it Blues Jam. Matt Strong was complaining. I haven't been laid in 6 months, he said. Matt is not young, but he's handsome enough and he has enough money to take vacations each year. Last year, for instance, he took a ski vacation to Colorado for 2 weeks. You got to get the hell out of here, man, I advised him. He squinted at me. Why? He said, I don't know. I said, I just think you've been here too long, that's all. How is me moving out of Iowa going to help me get laid? He said, I don't know, I said, taking another haul off my pint glass. The music was heating up, and my friend Saul, the sax player, had already begun his inevitable stroll down among the patrons, blowing his horn and making us all feel that we were somehow participating in the music. Let's face it, I said, and don't deny it. All the women around here know you too well. I looked towards Saul, and then after a beat or two, snuck a look back at Matt. I laughed loudly at his expression on his face, and he joined in laughing. Fuck you, he said. And besides, he added, after Saul had made his way back up on stage, I can't go anywhere. I'm stuck. I turned until I was facing Matt straight on, very interested in why he might be stuck. Why do you say that? I said. It's not like I got a trade like you, he said. I can't make $30 an hour. I'm a house painter, for bleep's sake. I go somewhere else and I'm making, what, $10 an hour? But here, I got a business. I charge $55 an hour. I got clients lined up, and I do a perfect job. They know that. That's why they hire me. But your house is paid for, he said. You could sell that, or, Matt snorted loudly, or rent it, or whatever. I continued, and that would be $1,000 or $2,000 per month, and you could, Joe, said Matt, patting me on the chest and pushing me back down into my stool. Joe, calm yourself, okay? Calm down. You don't know what you're talking about, okay? I can't go. Can't. Saying this, he held up his hands in the air like when the dove has just appeared behind the silk scarf, and voila, he can't go. And Deb can't go, and I can't go. Nobody can go. Life can hypnotize you into thinking that you have no choice, that you're trapped. You have a mortgage, you have a job, you have a wife, you have children, one of whom will never dress himself, never hold a conversation, never fall in love, and you will provide. This will be your life. What choice do you have in the matter? Things will always be this way. Enter the Wigan Pen, whispering her lullabies, the Wigan Pen, my hope and my childhood, my future and my past. It was only a few years ago when Deb and I spoke about the possibility of traveling to San Sebastian, Spain, or spending a week in New York City, or selling everything and buying a camper and traveling around the country. Maybe we could study the history of various places we visited, and the kids could learn so much more on the road than spending another year in school, and I could write and draw, and Deb could write and sculpt, and then when our money was gone, we could just get jobs somewhere and live in the trailer home. Why couldn't we do that? Why couldn't we? And then, thinking about these things, reclining in my booth at the Wigan Pen, I light a cigarette. And Deb comments on the way the drinks look amber and beautiful when she views them through her full pint glass of Bass Ale. And I exhale a plume of smoke, and we imagine things. We imagine things together, Deb and I. This is why I want Deb to drink. It's not because I want to destroy her. It's because I want to be in love again. I want the two of us to be brave and give everything away and be iconoclastic and idiosyncratic and artistic. And I have discovered that we can be all of this without changing a single thing in our lives other than our sobriety. So we get drunk and we get sober again and the days go by. I know there must be more. This advance and retreat can't be all there is. Freezing and melting, repair and disrepair, sobriety and drunkenness, sleep and wakefulness. The days go by, the silent water. But there must be more. There must be something absolute. There must be something that never changes. Use your words, we say. Use your words. That's something we say to Michael. It's all bullshit, though, sighs Deb. I know it, I say. I know it, I breathe. I glance at the game and then at my wife. I say, what? Deb leans forward, squinting. I know, she says. You know what? I say, I just know, that's all. You know what? I know about her, she says. I force a laugh. Really? I say, her, you do. You know about her. Who do you call 10 times a day? Says Deb. I didn't call. No, she says. Not who did you call. Who do you call? It's a hypothetical. Who do you call 10 times a day? Who do you call that often? Do you call anyone that often? A golf buddy? An auto mechanic? Who do you call 10 times a day? Okay, I say, I give up. Who do you call 10 times a day? Me? I don't call anyone 10 times a day. Jesus Christ, I say, is this like a comedy thing or something? You don't call me 10 times a day, she says, grabbing her pint glass. I know that. If you're so curious, I say, why don't you call the number? I tried, she shouts. Deb, I say, could you keep it down? Keep it down, she shouts, wild-eyed. She's a little hellion sometimes. She gets angry and let her run. She's like one of those tornadoes. keep it down, she shouts, wild-eyed. I got to pick William up, I say. Want to change the subject, huh, she says. The phone calls, I say, leaning close. They're about rotisserie baseball. I didn't want to tell you because I know you didn't want me doing that again this year. Bullshit, she says. Here, I say, pulling out my phone. I'll call Marty right now. You want to talk to him? No. I'll get William, I say, standing and shoving my phone back into my pocket. Hey, you know what? I'll walk over. You take the truck. but you just poured me another beer. How can I take the truck? Besides, have you looked outside lately? She throws her chin in the direction of the window. Rain, of course. How much time do I have? 25 minutes. So if I read the whole time, they can't ask questions? All right.
That's a technique.
Awesome. I don't know what to read next. Well, what did I read? I'll just read this. I'll just keep going. If you take a right, and this section just follows the last section. If you take a right out of the parking lot of the Wig and Pan and then left on Mormon Track past the softball complex where we play our league games, you'll hook up with Route 1 and be coasting through the rolling Iowa towns with bucolic names like Lone Tree and Richland and Fairfield. The road, I'm sure, doesn't care one way or the other if you drive away on it, and before long, if you take the proper turnoffs, you'll see signs for towns with names like St. Louis and Atlanta and then Miami, where, if you wanted to, you could apply for a job. If you turn around in the Hardy's parking lot, where a club called the Cruise-O-Matics has antique car shows every other Friday night in the summertime, you'll end up back on Route 80, which has no problem with you driving away on it either. Plenty of people have done it. You can drive straight to New York City and maybe rent a tiny apartment in the Bronx. Of course, you can also just keep going straight if you want. That will bring you along the Coralville Strip. There's a bunch of stuff down there, too. But I won't go any of these directions. I'll take a right on First Avenue and then a left on Fifth Street. I'll pick up William from his kickboxing class, and then when I get to the intersection again, I'll take a left because that's where I live. My wife and I and our four children and our dog and our lawnmower and our snow shovels and our high-speed internet connection, which cost me about $100 a month, and my bicycle, which I never ride, and my canoe, which never leaves the garage, that's where I'll be heading. The cross traffic gets the green and green light and cars move along. Sometimes Deb complains about picking up and dropping off the kids, but I sort of like it. I like it in the same way I like waiting for my clothes to dry in the laundromat, because there aren't really any decisions to make. You can't go walking out of the laundromat for half an hour and try to accomplish something else while your clothes dry. I did that once at a laundromat on Mass Ave in Cambridge, and three pairs of my Levi's were gone when I got back. You need to wait. That's just the way it is. With these things I repeat, like glancing at the red digits on the alarm clock before I switch off my reading light and roll over on my side and give myself up to sleep, it seems like the time between the last event and the current event is almost non-existent. The thing happens, and then it happens again, and so on. This has been my life so far as I can tell. There haven't been any decisions to make. I pull up at the intersection, and I pull up, and I pull up, and I pull up, and I'm always going somewhere. It's not like I pull up the intersection and then decide where I'm going. I already know. It isn't so bad, really. You have a good practice? I ask my 14-year-old son. William shrugs. No? Yeah, he says, looking away, I guess. A few months ago, when I pulled up to the intersection, it was snowing. The snowflakes were very large, having piggybacked on other snowflakes on the way down, like little falling nuclear families of snowflakes. It was the very beginning of a squall, and the air temperature was somewhere below zero. Still, the flakes were very large, which I remember thinking was strange, it being so cold, and I figured there must have been some temperature inversion a few thousand feet up. The intense yellow lights from the perimeter of the Hawkeye softball complex glanced off the black oil-soaked patch of asphalt between the four sets of traffic lights, where there was also some lights from the Walgreens on the opposite corner. I could see very clearly the snowflakes when they hit the road, drifting sideways in the wind and then shattering into tiny fragments, skidding slightly, taking their time to shatter. It fascinated me for some reason, these snowflakes shattering against the cold surface and the lights. It made me think of birds landing on water. You learn anything? I ask my son. William shrugs. I nod. When I get home, I'm thinking I'll need to put Michael to bed. I know he won't stay in bed unless I get in bed with him. I'll tell him to go back to bed 50 times. Michael? I'll say, get back in bed. 50 times. This may sound like an exaggeration to you, but it's a conservative estimate. And after that first 30 or so times, I'll need to work hard on staying calm. Shouting doesn't help. It only makes Michael cry. and then I feel bad and comfort him and tuck him under his covers, and then he'll stay there for 30 seconds, and then he'll get out of bed again. We never imagined when we named him Michael we'd have to say it so many times. Michael, get back in bed. It's not that he doesn't listen. He listens, and he gets back in bed. And then having gotten back in bed, he gets out of bed again. After I lie down with Michael for a while, I'll brush my teeth, and then I'll climb into my bed. Before I turn over on my side, I'll glance at the clock. At the intersection, I flip on the radio, expecting country or sports talk, but what comes through the speaker surprises me. It's Kathleen Battle, the prima donna who, as the story goes, while riding in a California limo, phoned her management company in New York to tell them that she was too cold. The management company then called the limousine company in L.A., who contacted the chauffeur who adjusted the set point on the air conditioner. I recognize the Requiem Mass by Gabriel Fauré. Actually, I know it quite well. But this particular version, so suddenly filling the car, unnerves me and shakes something loose that I thought was torqued down pretty well. One time, I drove out to the McBride Nature Recreation Center with Dab and the kids and the dog, and we found a camping area overlooking the reservoir. The wind tore at us, and we didn't care because it was a warm wind, and we couldn't help but run. I ran and ran, and so did Deb, and the kids, and the dog at the time, Maggie. And we were down by the lake, and then back up at the campsite. And we had bought sun-kissed orange soda at the little grocery store in North Liberty, and some chips, and 6 huge apples. And we had a little picnic in the wind. And then everyone except Deb took off their shirts and ran around like madmen. It was warm outside. The sun was out, and you could feel how warm it was. And everyone was outside in the wind. And then we went hiking. We all found sticks. Sam's was the smallest and the most maneuverable, good for blocking and quick strike. Sam's was thicker and more powerful. Deb's was whippy. Mine had a sharp spike sticking out of it, which we all agreed would be very painful. And Lucy had this misshapen, rotten little branch. That wasn't good for much of anything. "What's that do?" I asked her. "What's what do?" She said, "Your weapon." I said, "What does it do?" Lucy inspected her crooked stick. "Nothing," she said. "Look," I said, leaning in close and handing her 2 tiny twigs. "I have this gift for you. Use these very carefully. There is no more deadly weapon." "What are they?" she whispered. "They are the chopsticks of death," I said. "You can defeat a man with these. You can defeat any man with these. You can even remove a man's heart while it still beats." Lucy handled them with reverence. Michael picked up a lot of different sticks, small twigs mostly, good for whipping the ground with. Sam and Lucy climbed a tree. It was a pine tree, which meant it had even straight branches, easy for climbing. It was their first pine. "This tree's perfect for climbing," said Sam. I nodded my head sagely and told him about the pine tree we had next to the house when I was a kid and how we would always climb it and how we always got our hands covered with pine tar. Deb, William, Michael, and I sat in the ground in the pine grove. The wind barreled through the pine boughs. "I love that sound," I said. "It sounds like a train." "Or maybe the trees are talking to each other," said William. We hit the trail again, and Sam assigned us names. I was Ogre. Sam was Leader, of course. William was Old Man. Lucy was Woo Man. Michael, who had recently discovered the skill of clicking his tongue against the roof of his mouth, was the Clicker. Deb was the Pixie. And Dog was Anonymous Boot. We were walking through the woods. We had been hiking in the lowlands and marshes near Coralville Reservoir for more than 2 hours, following streams, sitting around in the woods. We had discovered ancient torture devices. The wind had howled. We had run. We had become covered in mud. Now we were trying to find the trailhead. 6 weary travelers. We begin our captain's log, each taking turns. "Sam, the food is gone. Everyone is hungry. The ogre has been giving me sidelong glances all day. I don't trust him." "William, the pixie is dead. No one knows how she died. There's blood all over the ogre's hands. I don't trust him." "Me, we must carry the pixie. Flies are gathering. The leader has a lean and hungry look. I don't trust him." "Sam, the ogre just stabbed me in the eye. I don't trust him." We were in stitches, lost in the woods, but in stitches. "Lucy, The ogre is blood all over, and the old man has died. We don't trust him. Lucy, the 5-year-old woo man, was trying, but William says she's not funny. She's just repeating. Lucy was undaunted. Lucy, the old man is stinky. We don't trust him. Sandeb and I laugh. Once in a while, you get a day like that, a gem. You're not billing, you're not repairing furnaces, you're lost in the woods with your wife and 4 children and dog. The wind is strong and warm, and there's nothing else. Eventually, you will find the car, and you will drive to Liberty Cones for a double scoop. Yes, that was a good day, but it isn't today. That day happened 5 years ago. Sam was 11 then, now he's 16. Now he's 19. William is 14 now. The twins are 10. We have all since then lost the belief in our superpowers. And Maggie, the dog, is gone. We told the kids we gave her to an old farmer, which is true, and that she's on the farm now. Absolutely true. And I imagine Maggie running in a field. The light changes, and we move forward to the left. That's, I think, all I'm going to read. What do we got for time?
I'll tell you. Lindsay at? Park, come on out and take a bow.
If anyone has any questions for the author, please allow us to mic up any questions for the audience room.
No hard questions, Courtney. All right, you can ask hard questions. What do I wear when I write? Generally, I write. Okay, good. Thank God.
Yeah, Joe, I noticed in your reading that you touched on many areas. And I was just wondering, you know, what was your motivation? A lot of time when people begin to write, they become very focused on one area. But you managed to cover multiple areas and do a very good job. So could you share with us what your motivation for starting to write this book?
Yeah, the motivation for starting to write the book was that I had about 1,000 essays when I got an agent. And I'm like, she's like, what do you got? I'm like, I got a bunch of essays. Isn't that cool? She's like, no, it's not cool. We need a book. I'm not going to sell essays. No one's going to buy essays. So I'm like, a book, huh? She's like, yeah, you need a book. That was my motivation to write the book. So, but see, what I did, it was a weird process, Speedy, because so I had all these essays, and they were essays I wrote with Lauren mainly, and they took an hour. Each one was an hour of writing. We'd write for an hour, and then we'd read aloud what we wrote to each other, and that was it. And so essay, and then you edit them. And now here I am with all these puzzle pieces, and I had to somehow, I knew that I had an arc. Actually, I ended up with 2 books. One book was this dark, brooding, like, kind of gnarly book, this one. Not the final copy, dark, dark book. And the other one was, I thought, oh, they'll like this. And it was like how great a father I am, and Michael, and like rainbows and pixies and fairy tales, and they'll like this. And so I send my agent both of them, and I'm like, I don't even think, after she reads the dark, brooding one, I don't think she's going to want me anymore. Like, she doesn't want to represent me. She's going to hate me for this. What did I do? I shouldn't have sent her that. I just should have sent her the rainbow one. But she ended up liking the dark, broody one and hating the rainbow one. And then it was, and all these things that I wrote and thinking that no way in heck we're ever going to see the light of day, where suddenly it was possible that they would see the light of day. And, you know, that's the way it happened, Speedy. I don't know. It was kind of like assembling a puzzle, trying to get it together, which they don't recommend, right, Carl? I don't think you're supposed to. I don't know if there's any way you're supposed to do it. That's the way I did it. I don't know.
Did your agent do any helping in the assemblage of the book, or did she just say, I'll take it like this?
No. She was very hands-on, but I was such a radical editor. I'd like give her one book, And then she'd like, well, I want you to change this. Well, I change everything. I changed the whole book. It's a different book completely. And she'd be like, well, this is good too. And now she wanted to change this, and I change everything again. So I'm a radical editor, and I just did these crazy edits because I kind of hated it in its present tense. And then there's that. I did the same thing with the titles. I named this book. It took me 2 years to name this book, and I hate the existing title. Well, I don't mind it now, but I loved it right away. I called him, like, hey, how about this title? And then my editor at that time said, okay. And they called the next day, go, that title sucks. I don't want to name it that. And she goes, too late. Because she, like my agent, I made her pull her hair out because I'm changing everything all the time. She goes, Joe, this has to be done at some point. This has to be finished at some point. And even still, I mean, there's like a paragraph that repeats itself twice within like two pages in the book right now, and we still didn't get it right. So I told them to edit it, but they didn't. That was the final file. And maybe you guys won't notice, and I should have said. Just read it quickly. Skim over it.
How good an agent was she? Did she sell it quick?
She's a bulldog, man. I was stupid. I mean, I had these agents set up to meet, and I went to New York. I felt really cool, you know, meeting agents. I get to meet agents, and usually it's like you're begging. If there was a week earlier, if a dog came down the street with a tag that said I'm an agent, I would have gotten the dog. I didn't care. Any agent. But I'm like, I get to meet agents. So the first one I meet is Janice Dono, and she's nice, and we had lunch at this very cool place, and she, in the Village, and she told me about Bob Dylan, and it was awesome, and she's so nice, and I'm like, you know what? Let's just say you and I, let's just do it. So you can be my agent. She's like, okay. And then I had to meet the other ones that same day and like pretend that I was, you know, what do I do? Do I call and cancel the meeting? I didn't know. I just still met them and got my free food and and like had to pretend that I was doing the interview. And I don't know. I wasn't very professional. It was all from desperation. It was like the same way the book was written, in desperation. It was just a desperate act of freaking just, I don't know, trying to break out of wherever I was. And I was like, please, just any agent. And so, but Janice, I mean, what you want, I think, from an agent is basically someone who's going to kick butt once they get your manuscript and put it out there and sell it. That's what you want. And luckily, she was tough. You know, she's tough. She got it out there, and then she sold it for me. You know, thank God.
That's great.
Yeah.
Such a nice story with agents. But that's,
yeah, well,
no, it means that she loved the book and she believed in it.
There's still time for it to turn sour. You never know. Nate.
Good. Joe, there's a lot of you in this book, and a lot of you having hard times. And this book is, you seem like it's quite possible you might get your shit together now. And is that going to ruin your writing? And are you going to need help manufacturing angst? Because I can.
I haven't spoken to you in about 2 years. You obviously
forgotten. Starting now. Yeah.
Well, I have a friend, Ed, in Massachusetts, and his mother just loved a piece in the Times about Michael, she's a rather religious person, Catholic, and she had this idea of me, I think, and she read the book, and she said, she told her son, it was like, this book is like totally self-absorbed. I'm like, it's a freaking memoir, man. So of course, who am I supposed to, I could absorb someone else, and it'd be a biography, you know? I don't know what to tell you. I know. No, Nate, I will always be self-absorbed. Okay, so.
Lucy? No, I don't have a question.
Oh. Hi.
It's So, Jill, this is our favorite question. What's next?
Oh, what's next? Thanks for that question, Venice. I don't know. She's setting me up, teeing it up for the sales pitch, but now I'm writing something that's a lot like this memoir, which is called Zombie Boy Loves Coma Girl, which is not a memoir. And then I'm writing a lot of essays again. So, and they're kind of like a lot of work essays, like the New American Dream. That's what I'm thinking about, is a New American Dream. What is it that we want now? There's a lot of blue collar in it. And a lot of, Deb and I have been, gave up our own business, and we weren't very good at it anyway, but we did make some money. And gave up the big house. We bought a little house. We're trying to do things differently. So, I'm exploring that. So I think I might have to go through that nightmare again of trying to piece together a bunch of little essays again, which I swore I'd never do. But maybe I'll write Zombie Boy. I don't know.
So was this, or like, what kind of agreement did you have to get Deb to agree to write this and publish it? I mean, how did that work, seeing as it's so personal?
I didn't ask her. No. She read every single page 100 times. I swear, we were both so sick of this book a couple of years ago. Now I can, I'm not so sick of it because I haven't read it in 2 years, but I had... She got broken in over time. I've been writing for a long time, so I've been writing about her for a long time. And at first I held her up like the Holy Mother Mary, and that wasn't accurate. And then I wrote about her like the Whore of Babylon. That's not accurate either. So somewhere in between is the woman. And I tried to get better at it, but she got used to it. She hated it. She kind of liked being Mary, but... But you know, it's just, you're so vulnerable, and both of us are so vulnerable now, in this book, and it's a bit startling because it just weeks ago it was in the dark, very few had read it, and when you write it, of course you're alone, and then you're completely alone, and you think there's no way, you know, no one's gonna read it. I can do whatever I want. I can do whatever I want. No one's ever gonna read it, and then. Sometimes when it gets thrust into the light, like there's a lot in there you don't want out there. I don't want this stuff out there, and I tried to cut it. But you know, it's so integral to the book. A lot of this stuff that I don't want out there, when you cut it, what you're left with is a corpse, because that it's vital. It needs to be there. So I had to sacrifice Deb's privacy, which is tough for me. No, tough for her. My privacy, my kids, I was easy on them. They just have cute stories. They don't, for the most part. But you sacrifice them. You sacrifice your, any sense of decorum you might have. You sacrifice any pretense you might have, any way you might want to look to somebody, like as they'll like you. You got to sacrifice it because for the sake of the manuscript. Because if you don't, your manuscript will be false. And so it's not something I wanted, really. I didn't have this vision, but it's what it is, you know, so.
Let's thank.
All right, thanks, guys.
Joe Blair.
That's fabulous, Joe.
My palm was sweaty, you know.
Thank you.